Secret Citizens, the American Revolution Spy Ring. The intrigue of espionage has always fascinated the mind. Historically, during all wars, both sides have utilized citizens to work as spies. The American Revolution is no different. During the Revolutionary era, both the colonists and the British used not only military personnel, but individual citizens to gather information. Some of these individuals are known in history, like members of the famous Culper Ring and Benedict Arnold. But what about the unnamed citizens that provided these services for the military? I would like to address not only the known, but the unknown men and women that risked their life and peace for the cause of both independence of the colonists and loyalty to England. John Bakeless noted in his 1959 book, Turncoats, Traitors, and Heroes, that these rebels, Tories, redcoats, and double agents are as necessary to the militia or political fingers. Let's start with Silas Deane. He was a Continental Congress delegate from Connecticut, sent to Paris in 1776 to meet with one of King Louis XVI's secret agents, Beaumarchais, to lobby for assistance for the colony's military activities against Britain. He's noted for saying, "Perhaps the greatest irony in the intelligence history of war is that while the British intelligence activity were highly successful in collecting information, their failure to use this information left it invaluable." Next, we have Nathan Hale. He's immortalized as the martyr spy of the Revolution, an American soldier and spy for the Continental Army. He volunteered for an intelligence gathering mission in New York City, but he was captured and hung. He never wanted to become a spy. He wrote in one of his World War journals that he would never take up the ignoble job of secret agent. However, Isaac Williams Student, 1856, wrote about the life of Hale and noted in one letter where Hale stated, "I think I owe to my country the accomplishment of an objective so important. I wish to be useful in every kind of service necessary." Next, we have Enid Crosby. Shoemaker and best known of John Jay's counterintelligence agent, a sort of accidental spy, after his enlistment was over, he was walking on neutral ground in New York and ended up invited to a Tory meeting. He then relayed the information back to John Jay. Alexander Bryan is next. He was patriot to the local committee on safety, served as a scout based on his knowledge of the area of Bemis Heights. General Gates convinced Bryan to go behind enemy lines to spy and the promise to send medical aid to Bryan's family. Bryan snuck in and gathered information about the Burgoyne's plan attack on Washington's army. When he returned, Gates had not fulfilled his part of the bargain. His son had died and his wife had lost the child. Next, we have a British spy, Joseph Galloway. He was a Tory, Speaker of the Pennsylvania Assembly, Pennsylvania delegate to the Continental Congress. He reported on political actions and personalities directly to General Gage, the commander of the British forces. But he refused to serve in the Second Continental Congress. Next, we have Robert Rogers. He was famed leader of the Rogers Rangers and later the Queen's Rangers. He joined the British side during the Revolution, due in part that they treated him better and paid better. He functioned as a ranger and counterintelligence officer and is best noted for the capture of Nathan Hale and the chase of various people of the Culper Ring. Next, we want to talk about women. When the war itself began, women were vital participants in every aspect of the struggle. Let's talk about Peggy Shipman. Although there is no proof the second wife of Benedict Arnold was a spy, there is a high probability that she transferred information that led to the betrayal of Benedict Arnold and perhaps the capture of British Major John Andre. According to Brian Kimlin in his book, George Washington's Secret Six, she acted as a courier of sorts between Arnold and Andre. Next, we have Anna Strong. A member of Washington's Culper Ring helped to pass along messages by using her clothesline. She would hang petticoats when one of the spies were ready to submit intelligence. The white petticoat signaled the location and the black petticoat signaled when information was ready to be picked up. Then we have Anne Bates, a school teacher that spied for the British during the Rhode Island campaign. She would spy for the British, posed as a peddler by the name Miss Barnes in the Continental Army, which allowed her to move freely around. She would identify weaponry and report to Sir Clinton's army on the important military information. Then we have Lydia Durridge. She was a Quaker woman, and at that time the British did not feel like Quakers were to be, you know, thought of, they were not a security risk really to the British due to their beliefs. She overheard a British commander planning an attack on Washington's camp at White Marsh. After making her way to American lines, she told what she had heard, and her bravery saved Washington's army. Next, we have Agent 355, another woman of the Culper spy ring. No one really knows her true identity, but it is believed by some that she was a member of the prominent Loyalist family. Morton Pennypacker of the New York Historian writes that 355 was with child, possibly Robert Townsend's child, and was eventually captured by the British and died on board the prison ship Jersey. Other historians believe that 355 was the code for Anna Strong. Then we have Margaret Campbell Gage, American-born wife of the British General Thomas Gage, and was suspected of providing information on her husband's plans to the Patriot mechanics in 1775. It was thought that she had a relationship with Joseph Warren, who was a well-known member of the Sons of Liberty. After this betrayal, her husband subsequently sent her back to England. Carol Birkin, in her article, It Was I Who Did It, wrote about women were protesters, propagandists, boycotters, and fundraisers. Next, we have African Americans. Both slave and freemen played important roles in the intelligence activities. A lot of their exploits are not known, however. One is James Armistead Lafayette, under the direction of Marquis de Lafayette of France. James found his way to infiltrate the military camp of General Cornwallis. Passing himself off as a waiter, he gathered significant information that included the number of ships and boats in the Hampton Roads area, including Yorktown. Using this information, the United States, the colonists at this time, were able to join forces with the French Navy and, of course, the surrender at Yorktown by Cornwallis. Some of the more famous spies, of course, are of the Washington's Culper Ring. This is a large network of information collectors, primarily individuals with personal or commercial connections to cities like Philadelphia and New York that permitted frequent visits. They were farmers selling produce to the British forces, merchants with business interests, or some resident agents with social connections to the British leaders. The major case officer was Major Benjamin Talmadge. He was a respected intelligence leader under Washington. He was noted for discovering the ploy of Major Benedict Arnold and Major John Andre. He also recruited Abraham Woodhull as the principal agent for the spy ring. Abraham Woodhull, also known as Samuel Culper Sr., he was a cabbage farmer, that had commercial activities with the British in New York City and provided cover for his movements about the area. He was hunted by the Queen's Rangers, led by Robert Rogers. Then we have Robert Townsend, Samuel Culper Jr. He was a Quaker and considered to be neutral. He owned a dry good and grocery store with Henry Oakman in New York City. He was also a silent partner in a coffee shop with the well-known Tory journalist James Rivington. Robert Townsend is also known to be hesitant at first whenever he began spying. He really didn't want to have any part of it, but his father really pushed him to be involved. Next, we have Caleb Brewster. He's kind of the ruffian of the bunch. He was a Continental Army lieutenant. He picked up the reporting on the Long Island shore and took it to Fairfield, Connecticut, where Talmadge's dragoons carried it to Washington. He used citizens of Setauket area to signal when information was ready and where to pick it up or leave information. Some of these citizens, such as Anna Strong, used her laundry to signal Brewster about when she had new intelligence for him to pick up. Then we have Benedict Arnold, a counterintelligence and considered traitor to the Continental Army and hero to the British forces. He changed sides after feeling unappreciated and left with huge debt. Known for betraying Americans for the British, with the trade of West Point for money in agreement with Major John Andre. Andre was captured, Arnold fled, and even though Washington wanted to trade one for the other, the British would not, and Andre was hung for being a spy. Nathaniel Greene, who was commander of the Continental Army in the Southern Theater. Colonel Francis Swamp Fox Marion was one of his militia commanders. He's also really the one about the Patriot movie. He had spies all around Charleston, such as Roger Parker Saunders, who was a planter, and Thomas Farr, a merchant, who had dealings in Charleston. According to John Nagy, the role of intelligence in the War of Independence has in recent years begun receiving the attention it deserves, as there have been multiple authors that have written countless works about the more famous spies. However, more information is to be researched about the lesser-known informants that did their job without notice.